my first training camp, and you know, when all the guys were around, you really never had the opportunity. But when it kind of broke down and you started playing exhibition games, we're in Norfolk, Virginia, and I had got hit in the ear, and my ear was huge. And he kind of took me aside, went out of his way to make a special, you know, cut out of the helmet where my ear would have no problem playing. And you know, you're so excited about it. And I literally stepped on the ice and made it to center ice. Got in a fight with somebody, got thrown out of the game right from there.
Well, when I was first drafted by the Sabres in 1974, I came to St. Catharines for their rookie camp, and there were about 80 guys at camp in St. Catharines, and I went to my first day to get my gear and equipment, and it was Rip that was there. And
but I think the thing that sticks out about Rip is he's able to bring people together. You know, his charisma, his charm, he's for as hard as he works nonstop, he's always got a smile and he's always encouraging, and he was just an exceptional person to be around and in a sense, mentor.
Rip loved the goalie, so he hung out with us all the time. So we had our own pro equipment guy that was in our room all the time. So I remember meeting Rip. He looked at my equipment and he says, we got to get you some good stuff, you know, because my pants were small and my sticks were not the wrong lie. And so he looked at all my stuff and kind of got me in the right direction.
I got called in to be a stick boy for the first time. It was actually during a game. They lost their stick boy and they needed someone to work the locker room for the Minnesota North Stars. So I got thrown in there, had no clue what I was doing, knew the game of hockey. But they said, here, go with Rip Simonick.
We were all young back then, and Rip was so accommodating. You know, if you need anything, I got this. I need, you know, sticks, gloves, pants, and some of the stuff didn't fit probably, but he was always there to help out. And, you know, he's very friendly, very easy to get along with. And, you know, you just liked him for what he was. And that was my first encounter with Rip, yeah.
And I sat with Rip the rest of the game over along the boards watching the game, and that was kind of my introduction to him, of getting to know him and what he was all about. And he was so excited for the work he did on the helmet, and then it lasted about a minute, and then the two of us just sat there and, you know, talked about life from that point on, and that was the kind of the beginning of the friendship.
He basically showed me how to do things the right way and have integrity, and he's quite a guy.
Robert Simonick, equipment manager for the Buffalo Sabres since 1970. Affectionately known as Rip, an ironic nickname for a man who's put in countless hours for his hometown team.
I think that was my father. My mother told me that I used to like to sleep, which never happened after I started working in hockey. But Rip Van Winkle, and I like to sleep, and my sister Dorothy can attain to that, because when it came to hockey, I'd be up at 6 in the morning. When it came to school, she'd throw a bucket of water on me to wake me up. So that's how I became Rip.
Rick Simonick's hockey career in Buffalo actually precedes the Buffalo Sabres, walking to Memorial Auditorium every single day, working for the Buffalo Bisons of the AHL.
Let's walk out the front door of 160 O'Connell, where I was raised. And me and my brother Paul would walk down O'Connell to Louisiana Street to Mackinac Street, through the train terminal, and there would be the odd at the end. So we would walk down and go into the odd. So I got an opportunity to help the team through my brother Paul and Ed Frankhauser, who was an assistant with Frank Christie, who was my mentor. So that's how it started. It was a quarter of a mile walk, but did I know that I was going to be there 50 years? I didn't think so, but I was hoping. When I was there, I made all my money by walking up to the White Tower on Main Street, and I would get 20 cups of coffee, cream sugar, walking back down to visiting locker room, 20 cups of coffee for the Buffalo Bisons. So that's how I started getting little tips here and there, a dollar here, 50 cents there. So, you know, I figured it's worthwhile for me to be here. So that's pretty much why I stayed. I really liked it. I was a pretty lucky kid to dream at home and say, you know, someday I might help the team, the professional team. And for me, reading in the magazines and reading the papers and seeing, like, get an opportunity to work with Jean Beliveau and you know, like, Billy Ray was the coach and Fred Shearer was the coach. I think out of the 10 greatest coaches in hockey, I worked with 9 of them. The only one I never had a chance to work with was Tobe Blake, and I wasn't even born then. So those are the things that I remember and the reason I kept going.
Simonick learned his craft under the tutelage of the legendary trainer Frank Christie.
Oh yes, he taught me ins and outs, and you have to be your own man, and you have to stand up, and you know, you help the players, and I tried to work hard, and as time marched on, I just enjoyed the game more and more. After the games in the American League, a bunch of my friends from the First Ward would skate after the game until like 3-4 o'clock in the morning. And then once the bug bites you, you don't want to give it up.
It was a natural progression for Rip to join the Buffalo Sabres after forming an earlier bond with new owner Seymour Knox.
I've known Rip since I was probably 8 or 9 years old, which is, it seems like just yesterday we were skating at Front Park and Rip was one of the rink guards back then. There used to be a Ted's across the street. We'd go skating and we'd go to Ted's and get hot chocolate and a hot dog. Pretty hard to beat that combination when you're, you know, at 8 or 9 years old. And we'd go skate at Front Park forever.
I was still going to a school. I was going to Buff State. I had graduated from Bishop Tyman and I was at Buff State. So for extra money, Seymour would see me at the arena and he said to me one day, is there any chance you could watch my kids? They like to skate and, you know, Seymour Four, Reed Knox and Helen, who was a good athlete in her own right, I would end up babysitting them at Front Park. So that he'd drop them off at 10 in the morning and I'd be there till 5 at night. And then on the way home, he'd pick them up and he'd go back to his house in Nottingham Terrace.
Rip Simonick has had a rinkside seat for most of the memorable moments in Buffalo Sabres history.
I remember Gilbert when we drafted him. I had a funny story that still goes on today. The two best players in junior hockey were a player by the name of Dale Talon and obviously Gilbert Perreault. So we had the first pick. And obviously the book, Spin of the Wheel, tells the answer. That punch spun the wheel and we ended up with number 11 and he picked Gilbert Perreault. So Dale Talon always asked me, Rip, what would you be doing today if the Sabres had drafted me, who ended up being a great player in his own right and is the general manager of the Florida Panthers? I said, well, I'd probably be driving a cab or Uber or something like that. I said, if you came to Buffalo, I don't think I would have lasted as long.
Okay, here's a chance for Mikey. He's gone! Oh, what a shot. Oh, a beautiful shot. Brilliantly placed shot by Martin just inside the Soviet.
When we drafted Richard Martin, we knew that Gilbert was obviously a superstar. And, you know, they just hoped that Richard, he was a good goal scorer in junior, played on winning teams, which Punch loved. So we brought him there, we drafted a few other guys. And then Joe Crozier sort of told Punch, we got to get a right winger, we got to get a gritty player, we got to get a player that's, you know, willing to put his nose to the grindstone and dig the puck out and be willing to scrap. And in those days, they all had to defend themselves. They were all tough guys, which people don't give them credit for. They give them credit for scoring goals and assists, but they were a tough, tough group of players. And Rennie came in and he finalized it. Joe Crozier's the guy to put him on that line, and the French Connection took off. I think they're the second all-time scoring line in the history of the National Hockey League, and can't ask for more than that. The big thing with those guys, they didn't have the fringe benefits like the players have today. Those guys used to play their heart out, but who was going to buy lunch? So the French Connection and Don Luce's line with Danny Gare and Craig Ramsey ended up being competitive day in and day out. Sometimes the practices were harder than the games. So with that being the second line and they're always going against each other, they just honed their skills. Both lines were outstanding. So that was a solid team with that two lines.
Around it comes to Rick Martin, up ahead for Perreault. Perreault coming to center, dumps it off the boards in the corner. Robert going after it, he scores! Brilliant, Robert! And the Sabres win it again in overtime!
There was no ventilation, no fans. They didn't have the equipment that they have today, but we had the rink guys skating around with pillow sheets and pillowcases, and we were trying to circulate the air and have some of the players inhale some of the fog. But we ended up coming on top. Rene Robert scored a winning goal, which was fantastic. It brought the house down and exactly what we needed.
Frost getting it in front, a backhand in front, Hasek with a miraculous save on Quats. Do you believe? Oh, brother, we are not worthy. Dominic Hasek does it again.
I've had probably 8 goalies that are in the Hall of Fame. Roger Kozier was also a superstar and had won the Vezina Trophy. Donnie Edwards was a great goalie. Bob Sauve, Tom Barrasso. But Dominic, he's the one that got the kudos. He won the MVP, won the Vezina, won the Jennings Trophy. But Dominic is he's a legendary goalie. I don't know if there'll ever be a goalie as good as him.
Can't move on it. Now he does.
That game obviously was nationally covered. It was, it was Stanley Cup Finals, and CBC, they happened to be started their interviews on the bench with coaches, and Lindy was coaching the team then, and they had a monitor on the bench, and Harry Neal was doing the color for CBC at the time, and when that goal happened, Harry was screaming, "He's in the crease! He was in the crease!" And Lindy knew it right away. Tried to get the referee to come over. They ignored us. They didn't come over. Gary Bettman wheeled the Stanley Cup out, presented to Dallas. He was out of town in a matter of hours, which was probably saved his life.
Behind me stood Buffalo's War Memorial Auditorium, the original home for the Buffalo Sabres, and where Rip Simonick honed his craft. There wasn't a piece of equipment made that Rip couldn't fix or alter.
He could improvise stuff that looked like it couldn't be fixed. And all of a sudden, like if you had a great pair of gloves that you really felt that you really loved those gloves and that they were pretty much done, somehow Rip would make them feel brand new.
And then when it gets to, the shot blocking, Rip, he had extra pads on my pants that he had sewn in. The first shot blockers that I wore on my feet were, we just kind of crafted them out of plaster, and they didn't look very good, but they did the job. And then he was building all kinds. I felt like Robocop out there at times with the stuff he was, the pads he was putting under my gear and stuff for blocking shots. It was great.
Funny, he did. He was a real artist at trying to make sure that, I remember, I think because I'm not a real big guy, my shin pads were longer back then and they didn't fit properly. So he somehow found a way to cut off the bottom 2 inches of the shin pads with a little saw or whatever it was and cut it off. And then he taped the bottom of them to make sure it wasn't, the plastic wasn't, hitting your shin. And he did a number of things. I mean, he was always there to help.
Rip would do anything it took to make the guys happy and comfortable and ready to play. And, from myself experimenting with larger jerseys to, equipment, cutting, altering and all that kind of thing, he was the first guy in there, "Hey, let's try this," or, "I watched this guy last night on TV and this happened." He goes, "What do you think if we did this?" So he did bring an awful lot to, my side of it, and he helped it out with the good suggestions and the willingness to make the adjustments to the equipment along the way.
Well, I don't want to vindicate myself, but there were a few things that we did, and I actually learned a couple things from the Buffalo Bills equipment manager. It was Eddie Abramowski. I had asked him, how did a Bills lineman never lose their jerseys? And he said that we use two-sided tape, and they would stick that on their shoulder pads. So we tried to do it with Razor, and it worked a few times, but obviously the league complained, and Razor was winning one fight after another, and he became the premier guy, so he didn't have to lose his jersey when he fought Dave Brown. And he came to the bench. He said to me, "Rip, I can't believe it. I just beat Dave Brown." I go, "Congratulations and condolences, because now you're going to have to fight every tough guy in the National Hockey League, seeing you're the heavyweight champ." So he just shook his head and skated away.
I came in to Buffalo, my pads were the normal 12-inch wide. That's what all goalie pads were. But if you played in the NHL, the rule says 12-inch wide, but all the goalies had 13, even 14-inch wide pads. So when Rip saw my pads, the first thing he said is, let's call the equipment company so they can come in and we're gonna get you bigger pads. Like, you need to be filling in the net. So I was playing juniors and all of a sudden this pair of pads comes in and it had the blue and yellow, the royal blue and yellow that the Sabres have. They had a Sabres logo on it and they were literally like pillows. They were massive. And everybody was jealous because I had NHL equipment. And it was all Rip taking care of it and taking care of the goalies. And
you know, it wasn't just me. I can remember him, you know, getting calls in the middle of the night from Pat LaFontaine that, hey, meet me at the rink at Saberland. I want to fix my skates. And Ripper would be getting up in the middle of the night and meeting Patty at the rink just to, you know, work on his skates so he felt comfortable for the next day in practice. He went above and beyond for everybody.
Rip Simonick's long tenure at the Buffalo Sabres has earned him honors from the Greater Buffalo Sports Hall of Fame, the NHL, and yes, even his hometown team.
Well, the Sabre one is the first one where they presented me with the Sabre Sword in the year 2000, which I was quite honored. The great thing about that was my family, they were all alive, they were well, family was good, my mother was still alive, my father had passed 5 years before. But the story with that is the day they insisted that they pick my mother up in a limo and my sister who lived in the same house on 160 O'Connell. So my mom said to me when I got there, she looks out in the front of the yard and she goes, what's the limo for? I said, it's for me. She goes, why, are we going to a funeral? I said, no, I'm going into the Sabres Hall of Fame. She goes, oh, it's about time. So that was the first incident. The second one was when I went into the NHL Hall of Fame. Was quite an honor. Rob Ray and Rick Jeanneret were the presenters. And just being honored in front of your peers is a feeling that's sensational. I mean, I had maybe 3,000 people there and, you know, always very nice. My motto was, you have to treat people nice and I'll treat you nice, and it's worked for me. So that was really good. That was great. And, you know, I'm honored to have these awards. And the last one is the Buffalo Award. So when I received the Sports Hall of Fame Award in Buffalo, it was through a lot of my friends that I played hockey with, and my brother-in-law played hockey with, Brian Cavanaugh and Sean McCrossin. So to get that, I was told that's probably the biggest crowd that I've ever had for an inductee in the Hall of Fame, which is quite an honor for all the great athletes the city has had along the way.
The job of being equipment manager for a professional hockey team requires sacrifice and countless hours. But it was Rip's late wife, Mary, affectionately known as Maisie, who provided the motivation.
My wife was the best. She pushed me. She made sure, you know, you get up there, you get to work, you make sure. You get home at 2 in the morning, you go up there at 7 in the morning. So, I mean, she was integral in my history with the Buffalo Sabres, I mean. It was always her. She lived and died by the team. We won a lot of games, and she, you know, like, born in the family. Her brother was the director of player personnel for the National Hockey League.
They were always together, and she was sort of his, behind every good man is an even better woman. And Maisie was really very, very special.
Maisie pushed him. She was a tough cookie. She had a heart of gold. But she was tough. She never missed a game. She was always standing outside the locker room. When we'd come out after the games, after everybody was gone, she'd be sitting in the old lower golds waiting for us. And they were high school sweethearts. He never dated anybody else. And yeah, she was a special lady. She knew hockey. She knew her brother was E.J. McGuire, the former coach, and he worked for the NHL for a lot of years. And she knew her hockey.
My wife would, you know, she could tell which players were good, which players were bad, which players are dedicated to the game, and, you know, like, maybe she should have been a GM, who knows, but she helped me along the way immensely. So, I really miss her.
Simonick is also known for different ownership groups over his 50 years with Buffalo.
The most important thing that I've found out is that they've all been generous. They go all in for the hockey team. I mean, the Knoxes, they came in, They took care of the players in the best possible way, gave them the best facilities and equipment. So obviously, they just ran out of money. And then John Regas comes in. John Regas was very wealthy and treated the players very good also. He had Philadelphia Cable. So after he had personal problems, the league no longer would let him be the owner and president of the team. And then Larry Quinn, Dan DePoffi, had talked to Tom Golisano about being interested in buying a hockey team and a sports team. And Tom Golisano is a generous guy, and he still is today. And he ended up buying the team. And the last, after they decided that they were going to move on to other ventures, the Pergulas had, Terry Pergula was, he had told me numerous times, he was a lifetime Sabre fan. When he was in Erie, Pennsylvania, he would stop on the bridges and so he could hear WGR and listen to Rick Jenneret, who's his favorite announcer. I mean, he's everybody's favorite announcer. But he was a Sabre fan. He knows all the players. He knew how good they were. He knew how good the teams were. And he's still a diehard Sabre fan who wants to win in a worse way.
Rip Simonick has countless memories from the last 50 plus years and has made a lasting impression on those he calls members of his Buffalo Sabres family.
You can ask anybody that played here about Ripper that, you know, he was an important cog, even though he didn't get any credit and what he deserved for doing the things he did. It was a low profile job, if you want to say, but it was a very, very much more important job than the profile.
Rip is a hockey Google. You know, if sometimes just text him or call him just to get an answer because I know it's going to be right. I can't trust Google and the internet, but I can trust Rip.
50 years, yeah, that's a long time. And, you know, the thing about Rip is that, you know, again, he's loved by everybody. He's a guy that, you know, takes time out to make sure that, you know, ask you about your family, ask about, you know, how you're making out with whatever projects you're doing and so forth and so on. So yeah, I mean, it's a long, long time when you look back at it. I mean, I look back, it seems like when I played was another life ago, but he's been around and God bless him.
Just being in my position and being around as long as I have and talking to people, that you got to put Gilbert Perreault there, and then you're going to put Ripper and RJ are the three guys that when you go somewhere, you talk to people, they're the names that come up all the time.
When Rip decides to walk away, it'll be a sad day. You know, he's guys like him, Rick Jenneret, Rip, Simonick, they're legendary, not only in you know, the city of Buffalo, but in the game of hockey. Just quality people, and it's a true honor and a privilege to know them and to call a guy like Rip Simonick a friend.
Rip is just loved by everyone, and he's been so successful in truly, you know, enhancing young people's lives and their personal lives. Never mind how they play hockey, he's influential in that, but their personal lives and helping them, because some of them, they didn't know much about banking or getting an apartment, and Rip was in the middle of all of that, and that's why I said it about 20 years ago, and I say it again. He should run for mayor of Buffalo.
You don't hear anybody anywhere in the NHL realm or AHL that'll say a bad word about Rip Simonick. He treats everybody fairly. He's everybody's friend. I mean, we would go out of town to different games, and GMs and coaches would run up to him. They'd want to be with him. He wouldn't seek them out. They would seek him out. And it was funny because a lot of times our GM at the time or whatever it would be like, oh, here comes so-and-so, you know, and they would just blow right by him and have to talk to Rip. And he helped a lot of guys. He was a father figure for so many players, you know. When they came here in the old days, they didn't have handlers. They didn't have the, you know, all the people they've got around them today. And so Rip took care of them, took them in. Mazie cooked dinner for him, whatever he needed or whatever a player needed, Ripper was there for him. So I think that's the biggest legacy, is just a good heart, and he's a great, probably the best equipment man in the business, maybe ever.
One's legacy is determined by others, but Buffalo-born Rip Simonick definitely has an idea as to how he'd like to be remembered.
I would like to be remembered on a Stanley Cup, but we got to get there first. So The main thing is that I've been fair to everybody that's walked in a locker room, try to help them as much as I can. And as everybody knows, the equipment staff, the medical staff, we do everything to help the players. We had a lot of great general managers, and our job is to make the players comfortable and get them to perform as well as they can perform. And if it happens that I don't win a Stanley Cup, I know it's been a nice ride, so I'm very happy to be a Buffalo Sabre.